Hello and welcome. My name is Dr. Latanya Collier. I'm the great-great-granddaughter of Robert Collier, who was the first black man in the state of Indiana to be executed by the electric chair that he actually helped build. His crime was for the murder of patrolman John Kane in Evansville, Indiana, 1914. I want to start out by telling you a little bit about my family history. Robert Collier had a daughter by the name of Rosalie Collier. She was only 10 years old when he was executed. She, in turn, had four children. Her youngest daughter died at age of five, so she had two living sons, one living daughter. Rosalie vowed that when she ever have a boy, that her son would be named after her father, and she did. That was my grandfather, Robert Collier Sr. He in turn had my father, Robert Collier Jr. My father in turn had me, Latanya Collier. So his legacy is still continuing. The way this documentary is set up, you'll be seeing me at an interview with my father, the Indianapolis Star News, my son who's documenting the whole journey. We're at the Newcastle Correctional Institution where they publicly display the electric chair. You'll see us conversating, then walking down a corridor, going towards the electric chair. Now, as I was walking down the corridor, I continued to feel drained. Every step I took, I felt scared. I felt like crying. It was so emotional. It was almost as if I was going through what he went through as he was going to the chair. Even though he showed bravery, he still had fear in him. I mean, who wouldn't be, knowing you're going to the chair and to throw salt on the wound, the chair that you helped build? Hey, come on. Anyway, you'll also see the video of the chair, pictures of the chair, and then I have, after that, footage of African Americans and our struggle throughout history here in the United States. Then I also show, after that footage, how black people have evolved from those times. I mean, we're still evolving. Don't get me wrong, we still have our struggles. We still go through a lot of racism. It's just not as bold as it was back then, but it's still going strong. No matter what happens, we're still evolving. So I want you to join me in passing on the legacy of my great-great-grandfather. His legacy was to pass on education. When they interviewed him, before they executed him, and they asked him, did he have anything he wanted to say? His words were, "I don't want anybody to follow in my footsteps." He wanted people to do better than him. He wanted them to get an education. And so that's what my family have been passing down for years, generation after generation. Educate yourself, do better than. Some people fell off, some didn't, but we're still hanging in there as a family. I also wrote a book in 2010 and promoted it heavily in 2016 around the 100th year anniversary of Robert Collier. The book is called Show No Fear. Now, when I originally wrote this book, the original title was Die Nigga Die, because as they were walking him from the jail to the courthouse, a mob of white people were yelling at him, cursing him, calling him out his name, and continuously saying, "Die, nigger, die." So I changed the title because several people had talked to me about how hard it would be to get this book out there. And a lot of white people in particular would be afraid to say the word. So, you know, instead of all the drama, I changed it to Show No Fear, because he did. He showed no fear. Even though there was fear in him, he still showed none. And this book I want to show you is just an amazing journey. This big, thick binder is full of information, 10 years plus research. I'm going to show you a little bit closer. So here's the front of it. And then this is how thick this book is. And then the back of it. But inside, I'm going to show you this. See how thick that is? All the information that I have gathered through the years. It's heavy. Just know that this is a very in-depth story. I mean, there's a lot of statistics, a lot of family interviews. I mean, I think I covered pretty much everything. I'm also working on the screenplay because I really feel that it's important. In addition to the screenplay, I'm working on a second documentary, which is entitled Robert Collier, And So My Legacy Continues. And I did this because I wanted a continuation of his life legacy. So we know about his story from this documentary. Well, what happened to his daughter? What about her children and then their children? And so that's what the second documentary is about, how the legacy continues. There'll be personal interviews. I'm going to take you to the burial places of several family members, so on and so forth. And finally, I want to tell you how I came about getting this story. My great aunt Mildred, which was his granddaughter, told me the story while I was in college at Morton University. I went to her house because I was frustrated. I was taking a criminal justice class, studying to be an attorney, and I ran out of ideas, papers to write. And she asked me, why don't you just write about your great-great-grandfather? And my response was, who? She said, your great-great-grandfather. His name was Robert Collier. You know, he was the first black man to be executed in the electric chair. And he actually helped build that chair. I said, wait a minute. Okay, how do you help build a chair and then get executed in it? She said, do the research. And so I did. I went and did the research, came back and talked to her. And at first I was like, okay, they set him up, didn't they? She said, nope, he did it. I said, literally, my jaw's, okay. So I said, what happened? And she said, there was a barbecue on the black side of town. It was called Baptist Town. And everybody was hanging out, and there was a policeman. Of course, they harassed the black people back then. And they were telling them to get out the corner. And your great-great-grandfather said, I'm not moving. And the police said, you're going to move, I'm going to move you. And your great-great-grandfather said, do it and die. And that's exactly how my aunt said it. And she said, when the police knocked him down, he got back up and shot him, took off running. And I will tell you the rest of the story once you read the book. I mean, it's so much detail, so much statistics. And in the book, I also have my college thesis on execution, back then versus now. So it's a really good read. It's a quick read, very in-depth. So I want you to join me on passing on the legacy. Should you have any questions regarding this book or any positive feedback, I do not do negativity. Any positive feedback, I will be more than happy to answer your questions. You can email me at shownofear1914@gmail.com. Again, shownofear1914@gmail.com. I have to say the one thing that inspired me most about this story was his strength. It's very inspiring to me to be a person who's about to die, and you take the last moments of your life to think about others and try to warn them as well as guide them. He was my hero.
Mama.
What?
Where are we headed to?
We're on our way to Newcastle to see the chair that great-great-grandpa Robert helped build and was executed in.
And how do you feel about that?
I have a mixture of emotions. I'm excited, I'm nervous, I'm scared. I really don't want to go, but something's in me telling you that I need to go.
Okay. Grandpa, how do you feel?
I'm interested in seeing the chair, but I'm definitely going to support my daughter. She's made this venture for all of us. It's kind of scary, but it's something that we need to do.
Okay. And me? My name is Akil. I don't really know how to feel right now, but I'm going to be documenting everything. But right now, we're on the way there.
10 years old when they executed him. I still can't think of the emotions that she felt. It was, ooh.
You have Mama, you have Grandpa, and you said their name was what again?
Tim Evans
with
the Indianapolis Star.
And
Mike Fender.
And
Matthew Andrick.
Who runs the museum with a chair.
Oh, he runs the museum with a chariot, so.
How long has the chair been here?
Just over a year.
Yeah. Was still in Michigan City before then?
And this is the first time I've been on this public display. Was it just stored away somewhere before? Mm-hmm.
This is kind of eerie. Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, I know that through my research, I found that in 1913, when he was doing time in Michigan City,
and a group of inmates were selected. They had to tear down the hanging gallows, and they had to build a chair. And he played a part in the tearing down and also the electrical part in the chair. But during the process, he got sick and was sent to the prison hospital, infirmary, I think they call it. Is it infirmary or infirmary?
Infirmary.
Okay. And that's when he got sick, and they knew that he was dying anyway, so they let him go.
So, and I didn't do the math, so were you a later in life student, or?
Oh, yeah, I was about 27 when I went to college. I had 6 kids and then decided to go to college.
Was you a single mom at that point?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And one thing I got that I'm proud of is all 6 of them graduated from school.
Mm-hmm.
And several of them love research. Love the research. He's one that won
them. Mm-hmm. Now, she said that there wasn't a lot the family didn't talk about.
Well, we
Robert
actually didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I knew I was named after him, but my dad never mentioned him very much.
Mm-hmm. And never what happened or...
No,
mm-hmm.
Right. And my uncle, my dad's brother, his name is Willard Mosley. He was a Marion County Sheriff
mm-hmm.
for, I think, 47 years, something like that, before he passed. And his son is a Marion County Sheriff, Willard Mosley.
Yeah, that's the one I was telling you about that runs the sheriff.
So he'd be your nephew and...
My cousin.
His first cousin.
First cousin.
His father, Grandpa, which was his father, and his brother... Because remember, Rosalie had 4 kids, one passed away.
Mm-hmm.
So 2 boys and a girl was living. Those 2 brothers, one was my grandfather, Robert Collier, and the other was my Uncle Willard. They were brothers. So Grandpa's son, which is Daddy, and
mm-hmm.
Uncle Willard's oldest son, which is Cousin Willard, that runs the sheriff's department, so they first cousins. I tell you,
mm-hmm.
this information, just, and the research it too,
mm-hmm.
I know I never got tired of me, though.
Like,
this girl gonna quit coming over here.
Change your daughter.
Oh, she's always been a go-giver. I mean, she's always shown a lot of compassion for people. Period. But this thing, she really outdone herself. I think it just made her a stronger person in my eyesight. She's always been a go-getter, but she's a lot stronger mentally.
Okay. Well, that's one thing she told me was that, you know, she learned a lot about herself and
yeah.
it changed her some and, you know, made her feeling toward even black and white relations, that kind
right.
of stuff.
Right. Yeah.
The other thing I think is really interesting and, you know, still telling 100 years later was his final message about education. You know, we have a horrible time in Indianapolis right now with,
right.
you know, young black men being killed
right.
and killing them
each
themselves. Yeah. And, you know, that... That message he gave 100 years ago
is still ringing
today, yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah, October 16th will be 100 years since.
And you know, I didn't know yet, Brooklyn, until you brought all this stuff.
And they were calling it consumption or something.
Consumption.
Yeah.
Is what they call it. Yeah.
Have you read the book?
Yeah, yeah.
He was impressed because he thought he was just going to be like, I made great-grandpa into a hero or something. But
that's why I told her. I thought she did a good job of, you know, not... sugarcoating it, you know, or saying he was, and then, you know, he faced discrimination and stuff, but you didn't try to just blame it all on that and say,
right.
well, you know, he was an innocent man who wrongly
right.
convicted. Still, you think when a shooting happens early morning on a Sunday and you plead guilty on Monday and you're sentenced to death on Thursday,
something wrong.
Yeah, and then executed 4 months later, something happens.
He didn't have a chance in high water. That's why he just said, whatever.
And I remember her calling me when she got here.
Mm-hmm.
This was his gravesite. And she called me. Remember
I was in Evansville. Yeah.
I was supposed to win.
I did. It was emotional. I didn't think I was going to break down.
Right now, we are walking down to the museum where the chair is being hailed. That's the museum doors.
A wide variety of specialized training courses.
Excuse me.
The doors.
This right here is the chair. Kind of airy. Okay, well, how do y'all feel? Mama? Excuse me? Any words, Mama? Grandpa? Speechless right now? Brings you down to reality, I could tell you that much. Grandpa, while she's trying to get herself together, do you have any words on it on how it make you feel or what you expected and what you see now?
After that visit. So, Daddy, how are you feeling after seeing the chair?
It kind of hurt me to see you seeing the chair. You know, I got mixed emotions about seeing the chair, but, you know, I can envision him walking to that chair and saying the words, saying, you know, he holds help somebody else. Hey, that's cold. That's real brave. Talking about a brave man.
Yeah,
he was a brave man. And I got to say, he was a brave man. And I just, you know, I'm a little hurt, baby. I know
that feeling. Akil, how you feel about seeing that chair?
I don't know. It's kind of messed up. I really don't know how to feel about it because I wasn't expecting it really. I don't know. It was just different. So, I really don't know how to feel about it. I feel weird. I can lightweight imagine, like, what he was thinking and what he was feeling. Walking to the chair and walking down the hallway knowing what chair he was going to that he helped build. But at the same time, it's just like Grandpa said, it's mixed emotions right now, so.
Yeah, well.
There's some powerful stuff I can tell you that.
I can tell you right now, I feel numb, and I don't feel like talking.
It is.
Some loving here today. Yeah. escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love and beauty here today. Picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? Everybody thinks we're wrong. Oh, but who are they to judge us? Simply cause our hair is long. Oh, you know that we've got to find a way. Bring some understanding here today. Oh, oh, oh. Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me. With brutality, come on, talk to me. You can see what's going on.